गुड आफ्टरनून।
वेलकम मैडम। थैंक
वेलकम जी, थैंक यू सो मच।
या यू कैन। सो सर, आवर मीटिंग इज नाउ ऑलरेडी लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब एंड ऑल आवर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड मेंबर्स एंड द ऑनरेबल ऑडियंस थ्रू आउट द कंट्री। I am very happy to share with you that the institutions created by Dr. Varghese Kurian are celebrating Dr. Varghese Kurian birth centenary year, and this celebration started from 26th of November 2020. It will go on up to 26th of November 2021. As a part of these celebrations, we are trying to bring goodness of milk to the consumers and to the concerned stakeholders in a very clear way and from the mouth of the experts in this, so that we remain science based and we claim our advantage on the technologies and science and whatever we say. So in this series we are starting this lecture today, and to begin with I will be requesting the director of IRMA, Institute of Rural Management, to give a welcome address. Just to give a brief introduction about Professor Shashwata, who is sitting beside me. He is a acting director of the IRMA, and he has a more than 35 years of professional experience. And he has conducted more than 100 management development programs in India and abroad. And especially is expert on team building, group dynamics, executive effectiveness, and leadership. His major areas of research interest are in the area of management and governance of cooperatives and not-for-profit making organizations. He has consulted for several national and international organizations. He has worked on consumer education programs for packaged milk, HR in dairy cooperatives, and marketing strategies for dairy federations in different states. He has published widely in national and international journals and is the chief editor of International Journal of Rural Management. And he is an editorial board of several other journals in India and abroad. Is a member at large on the board of directors of International Association of Applied Psychology also. So he has many facets, and he is an expert to help us, especially dairy business in a cooperative or collective board. So I welcome Professor Biswas and request him to give his welcome address.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Prajapati, and for this kind introduction. And I take this opportunity to welcome we have a list of, okay, Dr. Menon
Mohan,
Dr. Mohan, and I was just going through your, and we are so happy to have you here on behalf of the Institute of Rural Management. I welcome you, sir. And this session, as I was talking to Dr. Prajapati, that is going to be very useful for many people, people like us also, who are new to this field of science. You know, I'm a social scientist in the field of management, so I know very little of science that you practice. And I think it will be very useful for all of us. And I also learned that we have, Dr. A.K. Srivastava with us, and other dignitaries, the president of IDA, chairman IDA, member of gut microbiota, member Probiotic Association of India, members of Swedish South Asian Network on Fermented Foods. Some faculty members from IRMA are also joining, faculty members of SMC Dairy College Science, CEOs and managing directors of various dairy plants, MDGCMMF, ED-NDDB, and members scientific panel of SSI, and students of dairy science as well as IRMA. And I think we are also live on YouTube. So it's a very big webinar we are going to have. Dr. Mohan, I'm so thankful to you for having accepted our invitation to address this webinar, address all of us. And thank you so much. Now I will hand over this to Dr. Prajapati to introduce Dr. Mohan, sir.
Please. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. And I'm very happy to see Sri Sunil Mehraji on the screen. He's a retired judge of High Court of our country, Mumbai. And probably we have some people from the Juhu Beach Workers Association. Our chairman of West Zone of IDA has motivated some important people in this group because they are all health conscious. And then everybody is eager to hear Dr. Mohan. Especially we'll have with us Sri Jandibai, Minaben, Ashok, Barotji, and I am not able to see everybody on the screen, but I'm very happy that we have dignitaries on the dais at the moment. It is over Zoom, and there are many people on the YouTube channel. So as I told in the beginning that this time, India is the world's largest milk producer, and in India, dairy is not simply business, but it is a model for socio-economic development of rural India, where almost 80 million farmers live on this thing. So we have to propagate the goodness of milk to the larger society in the interest of the health of the people and the society. As all of you know, we are drinking milk since centuries, where there was no diabetes or no hypertension, nothing there. Even at that time also milk was consumed in plenty. So milk is only responsible for these diseases. Those diseases would have been at that time also, but it is not so. And it becomes very painful to learn when some, say, lay persons are talking, but sometimes some doctors are also talking without taking the help of science. And that is why we thought that there can be nobody better than Dr. Mohan to talk on this topic, because he is probably the topmost doctor, diabetologist in the country, and very well known throughout the world. And just to brief him, I will just take 2 minutes to introduce him. So Dr. Mohan is a chairperson of Dr. Mohan's Diabetes Specialty Center and is president of Madras Diabetic Research Foundation in Chennai. He has more than 50 diabetic centers across the state, and he has more than 5 lakhs patients registered. I heard that he has more than about 15,000 doctors under his team working. So there cannot be much larger pool than these working specially on diabetes. His main research interests are epidemiology of diabetes and its complications, genomics of diabetes, and fibrocalculus pancreatic diabetics. He has been conferred with fellowship from all the royal colleges of the physicians. And he is also having the 3 scientific science academies of India, including fellowship of Indian National Science Academy. He has received over 180 awards, including Dr. B.C. Roy National Award by Medical Council of India and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Centenary Award for Excellence in Biomedical Research from ICMR, the highest award for biomedical research in India. In 2018, he received Harold Rifkin Award from the American Diabetic Association, and he is the first Indian to receive this award. The list is very long, but I will cut it short. Recently, he has been confirmed with the Fellowship of Royal Society of Edinburgh from Royal Society of Edinburgh. He has published over 1,340 papers in peer-reviewed journals, including 867 original articles, 380 volumes, 168 chapters of textbooks on diabetics and medicine. His work has received over 136,000 citations and H index of 136. See, you can see a practicing physician or diabetologist having such a research work is something exceptional, and that we admire Dr. Mohan for you. And in 2012, Dr. Mohan was awarded with Padma Shri, the 4th rank award of Government of India. And Dr. Mohan is also an author of book Making Excellence in Habit, Excellence in Habit, The Secret to Building a World-Class Healthcare System in India, published by Peggy India, and available on Amazon India. So Only last month we had a very good lecture from Dr. Mohan through our Gut Microbiota Foundation, and we all appreciated, and that gave me idea that it is better that we cannot have better person than Dr. Mohan to talk on goodness of milk. So with these few words, I invite Dr. V. Mohan to deliver his talk. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Professor Prajapati, for that very kind introduction and for inviting me to this meeting. I'd also like to thank Dr. Shashwata Bishwas, Dr. A.K. Srivatsav, and many of my other friends. I can see Dr. Nirja here, Dr. Sunita Grover here, and many, many other good friends. I know that I'm in the midst of giants in this particular field, and I also greatly admire Dr. Kurian for his for the work that he has set up and the monumental work that he has done, and therefore on the occasion of his centenary of his birth, it's a great privilege and honor to address you here today. Let me share my slides. I hope it is seen. My slides are seen. So
yes,
let me, without further ado, get in straight into the subject. And quite coincidentally, this is a thing on which I have done a lot of work, and this work has been building over the years, and it's kind of culminated quite recently, and therefore I thought it's quite appropriate when Dr. Prajapati called me that I've really not addressed the dairy association, although with the Gut Microbiota and the Probiotic Association I've dealt, but I've not specifically spoken about milk or dairy to them. So I thought this is the first time actually I'm talking on this subject. And when I started putting my slides together, I realized what a powerful talk this is actually. And a lot of people actually have to hear this, because in the media and social media with all the fake news, we keep hearing so many wrong things. And milk is treated as if it is a villain, and as if all the diseases of humanity come because of milk and dairy. And I'm going to show you data to show you it's exact opposite. If at all, this is what is contributing to your health. And this is not just my data. It's not my bias. I'm going to show you data from all over the world, which are published in the best journals in the world consistently, which is showing the same thing. And we have Indian data also now to support that. Once again, to just formally thank Dr. Prajapati, Dr. Srivatsava, and Professor Shashwata Bishwas, and all the organizers and all the other associations, including the not only the Varghese Kurian Center of Excellence, but also the Indian Dairy Association, all the other associations which Dr. Prajapati and Dr. Bishwas mentioned, who are part of this. So this is the structure of my talk. I'll just start with an introduction about milk in mythology, just to tell you that milk is nothing new. It's not that last 50 years some fad came and we started, like many other fads which we have today in foods and so on. This is something which has been there from time immemorial, ever since human beings were there. Milk has also been there. And as Dr. Prajapati said, it was so bad, we would have realized it long ago. And then some general facts about milk and health. Why milk, leave alone diabetes and other things, why milk itself is very important for health. Then I'll specifically go to my field, milk, association of milk with diabetes and metabolic syndrome. I'll explain what metabolic syndrome is. I'll show you one slide on what is the mechanism. Most importantly, we have the most powerful data now that taking milk and dairy makes you live longer. And this, I think, is one of the best studies ever done in the world. I don't think you can get a better study than this. To repeat that study will take you another 20 years. If somebody is going to challenge the study, you'll have to work for another 20 years to disprove that study. That's how strong that study is. And finally, I'll just end with my conclusions and my take-home message. So let's start with milk and mythology. So it's very interesting that in Greek, Egyptian mythology, I'm sure to you, I'm carrying coal to Newcastle and tell you these facts. But to me, it was new that in Egyptian mythology, Hathor is one of the main cattle deities, and Hesat is an ancient Egyptian goddess in the form of a cow, and Hesat is one of Hathor's manifestations. In fact, they even have this picture of Hathor, of to whom Hesat is closely related. So right from Greek mythology, leave alone Indian mythology, from Greek mythology itself, a cow is considered something sacred. They're calling it as a deity. That means actually they worship the cow. And so why shouldn't we worship something which the cow gives, or the cow itself? We are criticized so much for all that. But we are not the only people in the world, obviously, who do that. Coming to Indian mythology, the legend of the Samudra Manthan and the churning of the ocean Now you may argue that the amrit which came from there, is it really milk or is it nectar? And some people say, no, it is actually milk in the form of nectar which came out and so on. But even if you leave that alone, the Kamadenu, the goddess Kamadenu, the wish-granting cow, is revered as something which, you know, if you have the Kamadenu with you, all your wishes are granted and you're going to have unlimited, success and wealth and so on. So that is something which is there in the Hindu mythology. And then, of course, Krishna. Who doesn't know Krishna, the Hindu god, who is a cowherd and his love for butter is legendary. And this is what, 5,000 years ago or more. And he is lovingly known as the Makkan Chor, which means butter thief. And so milk, butter, all these things have been there in our folklore. It is there in our mythology. It's there in our religion. It's part of our culture. And as both Dr. Vishwas and Dr. Prajapati said, you cannot differentiate these two and say, no, milk is something. It's not like pizza that we had, you know. Having mentioned pizza, 1979, when I went to US for the first time, I finished my MBBS and went out to the US. And one of the professors took me out for dinner and he said, will you have pizza? And I asked him, what is that? You know, and he said, pizza, he said. I said, I'm sorry, I come from India. I don't know what's pizza. So in 79, I had not heard of pizza, leave alone eaten pizza, you know, and this is after my MBBS. So these are all new things which have come. So if you say pizza is good or bad, you can argue, but you cannot argue that milk is good or bad, you know. So it has a different history. That's what I'm trying to say. Now let's talk about milk and health. Now milk has these following things which nobody can take away from us. This is a composition of milk. Even the worst critic cannot say that milk has calcium, which helps you build and maintain strong bones and teeth. If children don't take enough milk, starting with the mother's milk, of course, and then going on to other milk, you cannot get strong bones and teeth. Riboflavin, if you don't have the B-complex riboflavin, your red blood cell production metabolism will go down. Phosphorus, again needed for bones. Vitamin D, again responsible for the absorption of calcium. If you don't have vitamin D, your calcium cannot get absorbed. Pantothenic acid, converting food to energy. Potassium, which helps to regulate and maintain blood pressure. Potassium is very, very important. Vitamin A, which is important for your vision, skin, and niacin, which promotes circulation. So right from skin, from your eye, from your heart, from your blood pressure, to energy which you get from the food, from your bones and your teeth, every red blood cell production from your blood. Everything is there. Something is there in milk which gives. So it can really be called as the elixir of life, if nothing else. Because what else other than milk? We're not talking about some alcoholic drink here or something which you can, if you want, you can take. It's not like that. This is something which is essential for human health and human life. Coming specifically to bone health, it prevents osteoporosis, very well known. And during pregnancy, I'm not talking about pregnancy, but I mentioned it in my earlier thing when we had Professor Srivatsav's talk, that you know, you need 1 gram of milk for a lady. And so you get 500 milligrams in a glass of milk and 500 milligrams from the calcium itself, if you take it supplement. And if you take 2 glasses, you don't even need that calcium supplementation. So for pregnancy, lactation, child health, it's very, very important. Now, in the context of blood pressure and heart health, calcium, potassium, magnesium, these 3 things, all found in dairy products, are help maintain normal blood pressure. So people have high blood pressure if you take potassium. Of course, I'm not saying milk is the only thing which contains potassium. Banana, for example, contains potassium. So that's why, the milk and banana usually go together. Even for our weddings, we give milk and then we give banana as a symbol. The moment the couple gets married, we do that. So potassium is there. And potassium is one of the most important things to reduce your blood pressure. And this is a very important role, considering that 1 in 3 Indians have hypertension. So if you take milk, your BP is not going to go up, it's going to go down. How can it produce blood pressure and heart disease? Very simple, fundamental facts which people are forgetting. And I'm not saying this because I'm talking to the Dairy Association or something. This is because they're facts. Facts are facts. It cannot change. Truth doesn't change, whichever association you talk to. Now, these are some slides I borrowed from Dr. Srivatsav. And this only place I'm going to talk about A1 and A2 milk. And the only reason I'm bringing this, and I want to thank Dr. Srivatsav, is from his lecture, which he kindly gave me. The only reason is because there was some controversy about the A1, A2 milk. And since he just talked about this and all of you, I'm sure, would have been there, I'm just going to rush through these slides. So this A1, A2 story started with a Professor Elliot from Auckland University in New Zealand, when he said that the Samoan children who lived in the mainland were more susceptible to type 1 diabetes than those who lived in Samoa and the island itself. And they said that it's because of the A1 milk, which was present in purely observational study. There are many such observational studies which come, which are hypothesis generating. Of course, in science, you never poo-poo all that. For example, there was a very senior professor, a very good friend of mine and my father, Professor Givagis from Kerala, who said that there was a particular type of diabetes mentioned in my introduction, fibrocalcific pancreatic diabetes, where you get stones in the pancreas. So it was the highest prevalence is seen in Kerala. Kerala also consumed cassava. So he said it's due to cassava. Everybody is getting it here, everybody is eating cassava, therefore cassava is due to. So if A is equal to B, B need not be equal to C, and A need not be equal to C. That's science, and you really have to prove it. So I did years of research and finally disproved his hypothesis, and he was very upset. So what, man, what are I saying you're disproving? I said, sir, you didn't have scientific evidence. You're just saying from Kerala they are coming, and Kerala they are coming, therefore there must be. This is not science, you know. You give cassava and see whether it's producing diabetes. And it didn't. That is science, you know. So from observational and epidemiological evidence, going to, you know, real evidence is something, and I'm going to talk a lot about epidemiology today. So to cut a long story short, they published and they said it's due to this A1 milk. And they also drew this line, which shows that if you take more of this milk and A1 and all, you get more cases of type 1 diabetes. But I want to tell you something else. You can use the same graph for another purpose. For example, you take countries like Japan, India, China, and all that here. Now, some of the countries in Asia and so on have very low prevalence of vitamin of type 1 diabetes. When you go here, Finland, Denmark, Sweden, they are Scandinavian countries near the North Pole. And that's the place where you get lots of type 1 diabetes. We don't know if it's due to the cold, or we don't know if it's due to the viruses which trigger autoimmunity, or what it is. But to say that it's due to the milk there is a bit of a long shot, and it really doesn't stand the test of time. And of course, they have also linked it to many other diseases, saying that it increases your cholesterol, which certainly doesn't. I'll show you the data. We have published a Lancet paper showing it actually lowers the cholesterol. And then, of course, coronary artery disease. Now, if it's going to produce coronary artery disease, then it should increase mortality, because coronary artery disease is the commonest cause. As I'll show you the end, it actually reduces coronary artery disease. And we've got very, very clear data for that. Type 1 diabetes is purely epidemiological, which was later disproven. High blood pressure. How can it produce high blood pressure and then potassium, which is actually lowering your blood pressure? Magnesium lowers your blood pressure. All the things inside, it's not salt. If you say something which contains salt, it increases the blood pressure. Or if you say salted cheese, if you take, it will increase the blood pressure, I agree. Or salted yogurt, if you take the salt, not the yogurt, it's not the cheese, okay? So you must be very clear about it. For example, I showed, just as an aside, we showed in a very, very important study which we published on cashew nut, showing that cashew nut reduces the blood pressure. So immediately the lay press picked it up, and they said, is it salted cashew or unsalted cashew? I said, of course, it's unsalted cashew. But even salted cashew, it will definitely go, because salt will increase the pressure anyway. And the cashew board got very upset with me. Why did you go and tell them that? Only all the people eat only salted cashew. I said, I'm not doing this to promote your salted cashew sale. I'm doing it as a scientist to say whether cashew nut is good or not. And then they're directly asking me, is it salted or not? I cannot tell a lie. I did it on unsalted cashew. And we give salt with the cashew, your BP will go up. And I'm showing that BP goes down with cashew. I'm showing a mechanism for it also. Okay. So what I'm saying is, you have to be very careful with science and with what you say. And of course, the later on, the New Zealand Food Association, Food Safety Authority, and the Truswell's paper, they all came out and said, no, there's A1, A2 milk thing and all that is not really true, and there is no serious effect on human health. Leave alone type 1 diabetes, none of these are really corrected. So the correlation only suggestive evidence, and there is no convincing, not even probable evidence that the A1 milk has any adverse effect. I think this theory did come up in our circles, in our diabetes circles, about 15, 20 years ago. Slowly it kind of disappeared. Now in the books, it is not even mentioned as one of the causes. It is removed, completely removed from all our books and all our journals. So I leave that alone. So what we have as kind of evidence against all that, including the A1 milk, is very circumstantial and really doesn't stand up to science. Now, coming to my field, diabetes and metabolic syndrome. I'll introduce certain, I know that you've mentioned not all of you are scientists, therefore I'll mention some very simple facts and tell you some fundamentals before I go deep into the subject. Now, what is metabolic syndrome? Metabolic syndrome is a fancy term given for five things which occur together. They are called a clustering of metabolic syndrome. What are these five things? One is blood pressure, high blood pressure. And the other last one is the high glucose. So diabetes and blood pressure occurring together, but also obesity. So waist circumference going up more than 80 centimeters in a lady and more than 90 centimeters in a man, for it's 90 for Asians, is waist, increased waist circumference. When this waist circumference goes up, two things happen in the blood. Your HDL cholesterol, your good cholesterol will go down. And good cholesterol protects you from heart disease. So that will go down. And triglycerides, another fat in the blood, will go up. So these are the five things that you, which are together called as metabolic syndrome. Now you may say, why these five, each one is important. Yes, each one is important. But if two or three of them occur together, normally they take three. If three of them occur together, we call it as metabolic syndrome. So if you see an obese person, generally, I'm just saying, you see an obese person, big, belly and so on, definitely, he'll also have little glucose intolerance. His triglyceride will be low, and his HDL will be low, and his triglyceride will be high. So these three will automatically go together. So they have metabolic syndromes. Anybody with a big waist already has metabolic syndrome. Incidentally, they may also have diabetes and high blood pressure. So even if they don't have it, it's metabolic syndrome. Okay. So for the lay person, you can just take it as anybody who's obese with a central obesity is metabolic syndrome. Okay. Now, so what is the evidence that we have? Is dairy associated with more metabolic syndrome or less metabolic syndrome? If all those earlier theories were correct, then you should have more obesity, more cholesterol, more triglyceride, low HDL, sugar should be high, BP should be high, everything should be high. If on the other hand, you find it is low, then something is protecting you from that. Now, whenever you do a paper, there can be 20 people doing research on it. And out of that, 10 may find one thing and 5 may find something else and 5 may find, because in science, nobody agrees. It all depends on the methodology, the sample size, how you do your experiments, how you do your triglyceride, how you do your HDL. Everything matters, you know, the quality and so on. So finally, the highest proof in science comes from a systematic review or a meta-analysis. In this, what you do is you put all the studies together. Suppose there are 20 studies. You put all the 20 studies together and see what happened. Then you will find one is an outlier. One fellow is saying something totally opposite. All the others are saying the right thing. Then this must be the truth. That fellow must be an outlier. So that's the power of a systematic review or a meta-analysis. So what did this particular, so these people from Korea had done this. Anybody can do a systematic review or meta-analysis. There is a way of doing it. Before a systematic review or a meta-analysis gets accepted, you have to follow a PRISMA method and you have to follow how you took the thing, all that has to be clearly spelled out, or there's no journal will publish it. Now, here is the results of total dairy versus metabolic syndrome. Let me again explain to you in very simple terms what these complicated graphs are. Because you'll see these graphs, then you must understand how it is. Now, if you take anything, let us take dairy. If dairy is increasing the metabolic syndrome, okay? Now, these are the various studies. There are about 8 or 10 studies here, which I've done. And overall, they put it all together. You can see 2005 to 2015 or 2013, all these studies are there. Now, if you pull all the studies together, suppose dairy is increasing the metabolic syndrome, then you will get more than unity. You can see this line drawn here. Let me get my, okay. So this is the line at the, unity is there, okay? If I get rid of this, let's see. Yeah, there it is. There's the pointer. Okay, so if you see, this is the line, the unity line. And if it is unity, that means no effect. By taking dairy, neither metabolic syndrome will go up, nor metabolic syndrome will go down. It has nothing to do with metabolic syndrome. So if you get it completely in the unity, it's like that. Suppose you get 1.5. Okay, what does it mean? There's a 50% higher risk of getting metabolic syndrome due to dairy. All right. What if it is 0.8? 0.8 means there is a 20% lower risk of developing metabolic syndrome if you take dairy. And they'll correct for all other factors. They'll correct for body weight. They'll correct for gender. They'll correct for age. They'll correct for ethnicity. They'll correct for everything else, socioeconomic status. And then they'll still find, oh, if it is 0.8, it means 20% reduction. Now look at these figures. So that's the unity. If everything, now this is a center point, okay? That's the mean, and that's the, what we call as the odds ratio, and that's the confidence interval on either side. And this point here, if it is right there, it means no effect. If it, the point comes on that side, it means there is increased risk of metabolic syndrome. Look at all these studies done by different people. It's not a country bias. It is not some Liu et al. Is there, Babio et al. Is there, Azad Bakht is there, somebody else has done, Martins is there. So people of all ethnic groups have done studies on this. Look at where the central point is. It's all on this side of the unity. Okay, that means it is less. Here is the odds ratio given. So I mentioned more than one means it is harmful, less than one is protective. 0.95, 0.93, 0.96, 0.83, 0.89, 0.84, 0.93, 1 went over, 1.02, 0.66, 0.91. So out of all these studies, there was one which was almost on unity, 1.0, even then it's unity only. Look at that, so close to unity. All others are on this side. If you pull the data, it becomes strongly protective. There is a 0.91, which means there's a 9% reduction in developing metabolic syndrome. The first slide I'm going to explain in detail. Later on, you'll be able to understand the slides easily. So the 9% reduction in metabolic syndrome based on the total dairy that you take, which means milk, cheese, yogurt, all put together, there's a 9% reduction. And see that the, when you take the confidence intervals, this is a confidence interval, it is not touching one. If it touches one, it is not statistically significant. It is not touching one. The lower limit is 0.85, higher limit is 0.96. That means it is statistically significant. That's the midpoint, which is clearly away from one. That means it is protective. Dairy is protective against metabolic syndrome, right? Now let's look at milk. Same story, it's 0.87, statistically significant. So milk is also protective. If you take milk separately, it is protective against metabolic syndrome. This is published in British Journal of Nutrition. It's not an ordinary journal. Next, take yogurt, definitely protective, 0.82, 18% less risk of developing metabolic syndrome. There are only three studies, but all the three studies showed the same thing. Now, the conclusion from this study was, this meta-analysis showed that specific types of dairy food consumption, such as milk and yogurt, as well as total dairy product, were inversely related to the risk of metabolic syndrome and its components, not just metabolic syndrome as such. But if you took each of them, you took triglyceride, you took waist, you took blood pressure, you took obesity, and you took diabetes, they were inversely related, which means the more you take of it, less you have of hypertension, less you have of diabetes, and so on. So that's the first study. Now, there's another study. Okay, it's a smaller study. I think it comes from China. Okay, so what did they conclude? A modest increase in daily intake of dairy products, such as low-fat dairy, cheese, and yogurt, may contribute to a lower risk of type 2 diabetes, but they are saying do a randomized clinical trial to prove it. But we are saying that it is protective, and this is coming from China, okay? And this is in PLOS One. Next, and here's their data. If you look at dairy with diabetes, it is protective. Look at that, 0.95, okay? Most of the studies are less than 1, 0.9, 0.8, point. There's one study, 1.1, 1.5, and 1.06. All the others are protective, and some of them are 0.82 and so on, 8.9 and so on. And overall, it's protective. So dairy is protective with diabetes now, okay, directly with diabetes. And so that was the conclusion. A modest increase in daily intake of dairy products, such as low fat, may contribute to prevention of diabetes, which needs, they're saying, it'll even prevent diabetes, they're saying. All right. Next. This is a study done from the, what I would call as the Mecca of nutrition. If there's a Mecca of nutrition, a Vatican of nutrition, or a Ayodhya of nutrition, or a Mathura of nutrition, or a Tirupati of nutrition, it is the Harvard School of Public Health. Okay, we collaborate with them. That's who I know. And these are the Vasanthi Malik and so on, are very close collaborators of mine. There are others, of course. There are Walt Willett and Frank Hugh. To take the world's greatest scientist today, go to H-Index. They mentioned my H-Index is 136. Frank Hugh is 246. He is, I think, rated number 3 in the world, I think, among all scientists in the world, all, not just nutrition, not medicine, not science, not physics, not astronomy, not mathematics, you name everything. Frank Hugh is, I think, rated number 3 or 4 in the whole world today, and he's still moving up. I think he'll come to number 1. He's from there. He's the head of that. He and Walt Willett both are close to each other in their H&A. They are from, that is from the Harvard School of Public Health. Whenever they say something, it is accepted as the gospel truth. And what did they say? Consumption of dairy foods and diabetes incidence, a dose response meta-analysis of, this is again diabetes incidence of observational study. This dose response meta-analysis observation study suggests a possible role for dairy products, particularly yogurt, in the prevention of type 2 diabetes. They're saying, take yogurt every day, you won't get diabetes. And this is coming from Harvard, okay? Next one is again from 3 US studies, this is in BMC Medicine. Higher intake of yogurt is associated with reduced risk of type 2 diabetes, whereas other dairy products were not appreciably. So in this, again, yogurt is coming out as little superior because it contains a probiotic, gut microbiota things, which probably some of the others don't have. So, but whole dairy is also coming out, okay? Now, what about Indian data? So you may say, all this is Western data. What is the Indian data? Now, I did not know anything about dairy till about, say, 3 or 4 years ago. You know, I knew earlier, but I was not convinced because it was circumstantial evidence and I was not working on dairy. So I didn't do it with any bias at all. But here is my first paper, again published in British Journal of Nutrition. I was the first author of this paper. This was published in 2009. This whole hypothesis in this is rice related to type 2 diabetes. And that's one of my favorite work. And the reason I got into it is because my spiritual guru, Bhagavan Sathya Sai Baba, gave me the clue in an interview with me. And he told me to look at it because I had not even looked at it. And he said, you've got the data. In your data, it is there. You have not analyzed it. Look at it. Rice, the more rice you take, you'll get more diabetes. He said, I did not think about it. Then I started working on it. And then paper after paper after paper, we proved the same thing. And that was what this paper was about. It was about looking at carbohydrate and glycemic load in Indians and looking at in our Chennai population. We've taken the whole of Chennai population, very large sample size. And this is our 59th paper from the Chennai Urban Rural Epidemiological Study. So what we did here was, let me explain it to you. We take Chennai and divide the population into quartiles, which means who takes the lowest rice, next amount of rice, next amount of rice, and next amount of rice. And that is what we call as refined grains. And you can see the diabetes going up, okay? We have corrected this for body mass index, family history of diabetes, socioeconomic status, income, everything, we have gender, body weight, physical activity. And after doing that, exactly as Baba has said, it has going up. So this is the first paper to show that rice is actually associated with diabetes. And the whole paper was on rice, nothing to do with milk. But in that paper, we found that milk was one of them which is protected. Okay, so this dairy is blue. You can see that dairy is blue and it is 0.54. See milk, look at rice, 5.31. I said anything above one is, risk of diabetes. 5.31, you can imagine where in that graph it will be. The one is here, it's going to go there, And I didn't even know that until whereas the added sugar itself did not come up because the amount of sugar we take, one spoon of sugar, like that, we don't eat that much sugar per day. Whereas rice, we eat like that much rice in Chennai and all they eat in Tamil Nadu. So we are able to see a strong association with rice and a protective association with milk. I have mentioned it in that paper. We are finding this protective association with milk. Is it just a statistical artifact? I have not read much about it. So I mentioned in the paper saying, I don't know why we are finding this protection with milk. But anyway, it's an interesting finding. And so I've just mentioned, and I've also said, maybe it's calcium. In fact, the next slide has it. So we said that, and what milk did we use? We used high fat milk. We didn't even use, ordinary milk. 3 to 4% fat milk was consumed daily. Mechanism, which is not at all clear. We said, is it calcium? Is it vitamin D? Is it dairy protein? Is it magnesium? Is it potassium? What is it? Phosphorus. What is it which is contributing to it? Needs further study. So I left it like this. This is 2009, 12 years ago. We published. Published 12 years ago, means study was done 14, 15 years ago. Okay, but then itself, we have observed it. Then I left it. I was not into milk much, so I left it off. I was working more on rice because we got that big clue about rice. And we published many papers after that, including with Vasanthi Malik, including with the Harvard group, where again and again we've shown that rice is harmful if you take in plenty. Now, this is another paper. This is CURES 142, the 142nd paper from this one single study. Okay, so I think it's one of India's best studies in terms of publication. So here what we did was, and you can see here, Frank Hugh is there from, Broad School of, from Harvard. He's already there in this there, Harvard School of Public Health. So Frank Hugh is already there. Vasanthi Malik, whom I told you, is there. There she's there. All of them are there. So we put this together and said, okay, if you want to prevent diabetes, what should you do? Okay, from the study, we found out who developed diabetes. And we said, you went back, this is in 2015. You went back and said, what will prevent diabetes? So what we found was, okay, if you take rice, your risk is going to go up. Okay, if you take fruits and vegetables, your risk is going to go down. Look at dairy and its product. 0.44 from one, your risk is, one is taken as a standard. Your risk will go down to 0.44 if you take dairy. This we published in 2015 saying that, hey, we found out in 2009 one study showed that. Again, this is comparing the lowest quartile of the milk with the highest quartile of the milk. Those are taking more milk, 0.44 from one has gone down to 0.44, 56% reduction, okay? And if you take bad diet risk score and all, it goes up very high. So again, second time we found that this is something very interesting. Second time it's coming that milk is protective against diabetes. Okay. But then there is limitation to this. Limitation is dairy consumption is markedly different across different regions, not only of India, but in the world. Some consume a lot of dairy, some consume high-fat milk, some contain low-fat milk. It's the whole thing is in a mess. Second, it's cross-sectional data. Now, whatever I show you in the CURES data, you will say it's a cross-sectional data. This is not prospective data. So what's the difference between cross-sectional and prospective? I'll explain that also to you. Cross-sectional data means I'm doing a study today. I set out in Chennai, Mumbai, Pune, anywhere, Karnal, somewhere I come. And then I say, I'm going to study the whole city. I'm going to ask what their people are taking. I'll take a food frequency questionnaire. I'll find out what they're taking. And I'll measure how much diabetes is there or how much hypertension is there. If they're taking more milk and they have less diabetes, I'll say it is protecting. They're taking more rice or wheat and they're getting more diabetes, it is due to that. It is not showing causality. It's not showing causality. It is only showing an association. Now, what you may, the people who are arguing against that, the science will say, well, those who already had very severe diabetes or heart disease already died. They're not there. When you're counting them, they're not there. They're not there. So how can you say that through a cross-sectional study, that this is related to that, those who are not related would already died and gone, okay? Or they may develop it tomorrow. How do you know? They're taking milk today. After 5 years, they may get diabetes. Today, they have not got it. So how do you know? So that's the problem with the cross-sectional study. The cross-sectional study is a little low. Of course, it's very powerful, but it's still lower down. How do you then prove it? You need a longitudinal study. Now, longitudinal study is very, very difficult to do. Longitudinal study, what you have to do is, when you start the study, okay, you do proper dietary analysis, you do whatever you want. Then you have to rule out that they don't have diabetes, they don't have heart disease, they don't have blood pressure, they don't have overweight, they don't have metabolic syndrome, they don't have anything. Then you have to follow them for 15, 20 years till they develop it. Okay, they have to develop diabetes, they have to die of heart attack, they have to do this, they have to do that, they have to get blood pressure, they have to get obesity, they have to get... And then you have to go back, oh, 15 years ago, what did they take? And now what did they have? Now that is causality because they didn't have it then. And you have the other group which did not take milk, what happened to them? Those who took milk, what happened to them? Now that's much, much more powerful. And that is the real science as far as epidemiology is concerned. Nobody will discount a longitudinal study because you are actually showing causality. And therefore you need longitudinal study. Who does longitudinal studies in India? It's very difficult. We are one of the few, the CURES population. We followed up the whole population after 10, 15 years. We followed them up again. But there are very few, okay? It was at that time that I came into contact with my very good friend, Professor Salim Yusuf, now at McMaster University in Canada. Salim Yusuf is actually from India. He did his MBBS from St. John's Medical College, and very much a South Indian. But then he went to NIH, first he went to England, to Oxford. He spent about 10 years in Oxford. Then he spent 10 years in NIH, where he was running the whole research of NIH. And then McMaster grabbed him in Canada and said, you come here. And they gave him, a head of the unit of McMaster University, where he has, I don't know, how many hundreds of people working with him. I think he's the world. So just Dr. Frank Hugh is telling you, sir. So they are in fact big competitors, Frank Hugh, and I work with both. Salim, just behind Frank Yu is Salim Yusuf in terms of rating. I think he's number 9 in the world or something like that. Of all scientists, not the medical scientists, all scientists put together, Salim Yusuf is somewhere there. So he started the PURE study. And PURE study started in India. It started in St. John's, actually. It started in St. John's. And from there, Salim Yusuf is a very ambitious guy. So started in St. John's. Then he said, why only Bangalore? Why only St. John's? We'll make it whole India. So then he called me. Mohan, you join me. I said, okay, I'll join you. So I joined, then Jaipur joined, then Chandigarh, PJ Chandigarh joined, and then Trivandrum joined. So we had 5 centers in India. Then he said, why only India? Let's get Asia. So he brought China in, then he brought this, and he brought Pakistan in, he brought Bangladesh in, he brought Middle East in, he brought everything in. Now, PURE is in 5 continents, 21 countries. That is Salim Yusuf for you, okay? 5 continents, 21 countries, 150,000 individuals who are being followed for 15 years. Imagine in 21 countries, 5 continents, 150,000 people followed for 15 years. That's why I said you cannot do another study like that. It will take another 20 years to do a study like that, if at all. If you're, and you need another Salim Yusuf to do it. So it's very difficult to beat. So once these studies come, they change the way medicine is treated. You know, all the books are rewritten, all the textbooks are rewritten, all the journals are rewritten, everything is rewritten once PURE is published. So that's Salim Yusuf. Okay, that's him. And so this is the thing I told you, 150,000 people. And these are the countries. So we were one of the first to do. We have about nearly 30,000 people in the study. And Bangladesh, Pakistan had a small number. China has 45,000 people in it. And these are all the country-wise breakdown. Total is 147 at that time. Now it's reached 220,000 people. And we are all coming to 20 years. And I'm continuously part of PURE. From day one, I'm part of PURE study. Okay. So we, you know, said, you know, let us look at, so Bhavadharani was my PhD student here. She did a PhD in Chennai, and then I sent her to Salim. I said, you go and work there for with Salim. So she went and became a postdoc, then started working there. So I told Bhavadharani, you know, this old theory I had 15 years ago that dairy has some association with metabolic syndrome. Let's do it in PURE and see what happens, you know, because this is a longitudinal study now. Let us see what happens there. These are all the collaborators from across the world who are involved in it. Okay. And this is now 147,000 people, 21 countries followed for 15 years. And now we're looking at prospective, longitudinal. They did not have diabetes, hypertension earlier. And so we looked at that. The aim was to look at, one was cross-sectional, to look at the prevalence of metabolic syndrome. And the second was longitudinal, to look at the incidence of hypertension and diabetes. What did we do? Dairy consumption. It was assessed by validated semi-quantitative FFQ developed for each country. We had data on 112,000 people for prevalent metabolic syndrome. Incident diabetes is based on 131,000 people. Incident hypertension is based on about 58,000 people. Statistical methods, I won't go into it, but very, very thorough statistical analysis looking at cross-sectional data, prospective data, incidence data, using hazards ratio. For cross-sectional study, use the word odds ratio. For prospective studies to show what is the risk in getting in the future, we call this hazards ratio. Okay, both are very similar. Now let's come to the so definition. How did we define it in our study? Total dairy was milk, yogurt, various types of cheese, yogurt, drinks, mixed dishes prepared with the dairy. Whole fat is whole milk, whole fat yogurt, whole fat cheese, and so on. Low fat was 1-2% milk, skimmed milk, low fat yogurt, low fat cheese. Butter and cream were not included because butter alone we cannot take it like that. And for this purpose, we did not take. So we mainly stuck to dairy as such. Now, one serving of milk was 250 ml, one serving of cheese was 30 grams, and one serving of yogurt was 250 ml. Now, how did you define incident hypertension? They should not have had hypertension earlier. Now they developed hypertension. They told you that they had hypertension with or without use of antihypertensive drugs, or the blood pressure has to be more than 140 systolic or diastolic more than 90. And incident type 2 diabetes, they should not have diabetes earlier. Now they have developed diabetes, or they are on tablets or insulin, and or the fasting blood sugar is more than 126, that is 7. These are standard international definitions. Now, this is the dairy intake worldwide in the PURE study. You can see the highest is in North America and in Europe. Now, what is in yellow, light yellow, is the total dairy. What is in little darker yellow is high-fat dairy. and red is the low-fat dairy. So you can see the low-fat is only consumed in North America and Europe. They don't consume it anywhere else. Look at South Asia. Low-fat is hardly used. Okay, the total and the high-fat are almost the same. Southeast Asia, the low-fat doesn't even exist. China also very little. Africa very little. South America very little. This is overall, putting it all together. The only place where some low-fat is taken is North America and Europe. And this, and the fat intake, the metabolic, the dairy intake itself is much higher in North America and Europe, not so high in South Asia. So we should be taking more of dairy, in my opinion. Middle East, of course, they do take, because they take camel milk and all other milk as well. Now let's look at the results. I'll push that up again. Okay, so this is total dairy. And again, the same line you can see. If it comes on that side of the line, it's all worsening. If it goes on that side of the line, it is better. It is protected. All right. Now, this is metabolic syndrome. If you don't take dairy, what happens? That is the reference point. You take one serving of dairy, two serving of dairy, and more than two serving of dairy, metabolic syndrome goes down. Okay. From one, it goes down to 0.76. And it is going down serially like that. Okay. Almost exponentially, it is going down like that. You can see 24% reduction in metabolic syndrome if you take total dairy, more than two servings. Look at blood pressure, goes down. Look at waist circumference, goes down. Look at low HDL, goes up. Exactly as HDL should be going up, it's going up. Look at triglyceride, it goes down. Look at glucose, it goes down. Okay. Now this is with total dairy. Look at whole fat dairy. If anything, it's more significant. Okay. So all this thing about you must take only skim milk, you should take only this. We are not showing that at all in our pure study. We're saying you can take whole fat milk also. Doesn't matter at all. Look at that. It's actually going down. Metabolic syndrome. BP going down. Waist going down. HDL going up. Triglyceride going down. Glucose going down. So with total fat, whole fat dairy, it does very well. And it's protective. Now, if you look at low fat, it's not that much protective. Of course, there is still a protection, but we are not seeing it. It's definitely not increasing. See, HDL, of course, is increasing. But the low fat, you see the wide confidence intervals. That tells you that very few people are taking it, because only in North America, few people are taking it. So this data was not very convincing. But nothing bad, even if you take the low fat. But the point was that the high fat is actually showing a very good improvement. So my message would be, don't bother. If you're taking milk, don't bother to take one glass of milk you're taking. You might as well take the whole milk. Don't bother about low fat or not. If you take it, that's also fine. Okay? That's come out here. Now, if you look at incident hypertension, now these are people who did not have diabetes or hypertension earlier. Now, with total dairy, incident hypertension going down, 0.89. Incident diabetes going down, 0.88. Okay? With whole fat dairy, same thing is occurring. One becomes 0.9, one becomes 0.88. So, this is new onset. After 15 years, how many people developed diabetes and hypertension among those who took dairy, whole fat dairy, and so on? Okay? So, we concluded from this paper, which is published last year in BMJ Open Diabetes, a very important BMJ journal, that higher intake of dairy was associated with a modestly lower prevalence of metabolic syndrome and most of its component factors with a lower incidence of hypertension and diabetes during follow-up. It took me 13 years to prove this now. What we just saw as an incidental finding in cures, when you're looking at rice, suddenly we found dairy is protective. Now we have proved it through a longitudinal study. Once you've proved it through a longitudinal study, nobody can argue that it is not correct, because longitudinal study, very few people argue against that. Now, what is the mechanism? I don't know the mechanism, but I got, Dr. Deer Singh had shown this thing was shown, and then he sent me this paper, which is in the Lancet in press. And what Deer Singh's work is showing is that the bovine milk exosomes and the microRNA 2478 enhance insulin sensitivity through increased expression of insulin receptors and glycogen synthesis. So therefore, this is a mechanism now. This is a basic science mechanism. We have not done much of basic science work on this. I'm a clinician, epidemiologist. I do some basic science, but not that much. So here is work coming out from the National Dairy Institute, exactly corroborating what I said. And therefore, the insulin sensitivity is, so I'm waiting for this paper to actually come out. It's in press. I'm waiting for it to come out. Now, milk and mortality. Now, you may say, diabetes is more, diabetes is less, or hypertension more. Proof of the pudding ultimately is in mortality. Okay. Do people die or do they live? Now, again, you have to do this in a long term. You cannot, as I said, cross-section study. Oh, all those are living now. What about those who died? All those who took milk must have died and gone. You know, that's something which people can say. If you want to prove it, you start fresh with people who are not taking milk, those who are taking milk, those who are not taking dairy, those who are taking dairy, and then you follow them up for 15, 20 years, see what happens to them. That's the ultimate proof. And very few studies like that on mortality are available. But that's where we go back to Pure. Okay. In Pure, you can get any data in the world you want it. I just have to tell an idea. Okay. And then we get this. Now, this is work is done by Masheed Dengan, who is a chief nutrition person at McMaster in Toronto. And she did this as part of her work. Of course, Salim Yusuf is the leader in all these studies. So here, this is published in Main Lancet. Okay, cannot get higher than that. The Main Lancet in 2018. And what we did here was we took dairy intake and then looked at cardiovascular disease, mortality in these 21 countries. How many people died? What did they die of? And so on. Objective was to assess the association between dairy and specific types of dairy products, milk, yogurt, cheese, whole dairy, low-fat dairy, with mortality. How many people died and didn't die? And major cardiovascular disease, whether they had heart attack, stroke, heart failure, all those things were checked. Here is the data. Okay. This is total dairy intake with clinical outcomes. This is the total composite, where you take everything, stroke, heart attacks, heart failure, death, all put together, cardiovascular death, all-cause mortality, all put together. You can see a nice protection from those who don't take dairy to those who take two servings of dairy, 16% reduction in mortality. Now, if you take mortality alone, okay, this includes those who had just heart attack but didn't die. They are also included. Take mortality alone, nice reduction, 17% reduction. Take cardiovascular disease alone, where they didn't die, nice protection. Okay. Now you take non-CV death, not just CV death, but any death you take, again, there's a protection. You take CV death, again, there's a protection. You take heart attack, again, there's a protection. Take stroke, there's a big protection. In fact, the biggest protection came in stroke, you know, 34% reduction, highly significant statistically. Okay. So it protects against heart attack, protects against stroke, protects against CV death, protects against any other death, mortality, protects against getting a heart attack, protects against any cause of death. Okay. And you put it all together, composite also. No, this is very, very, very powerful data. I mean, it was published in the Lancet, the whole world was talking about it. The whole social media was kind of ablaze with activity about this particular paper. In fact, it was rated as one of the best papers published that year. Now, if you look at, what we did here was, we took places where dairy is not consumed much, like China, Southeast Asia, South Asia, and Africa. They don't take much dairy. You saw in the first graph where they don't take. Then we took places where they take a lot of dairy, high intake, Europe, North America, South America, Middle East, okay, where they take a lot of it. We saw in the low intake area and the high intake area, are you still able to see the effect? Even in the low intake area, you're seeing the effect. In the high intake area, also you're seeing the effect. So it's not in North America alone they took and therefore they got the effect. Therefore, the whole world they are extrapolating. No, you've done it country by country, region by region. Everything we have done, it's so thorough. Pure is such a thorough study that you can show it again and again. The data is, you know, because reviews ask for this. So we get all this data. Now, if you look at individual components in the same study, yogurt, protective. If you look at, this is yogurt. If you look at the mortality is coming down, CVD coming down, altogether coming down. Take milk, yes, coming down. Mortality coming down, major CVD coming down. So milk is also protective, yogurt is also protective. Because in some of the other studies, they had only yogurt, not milk. Here we are seeing milk is also protective. You can see how it's coming down. Okay. So what did we conclude? Dairy consumption associated with lower risk of mortality and major cardiovascular disease events in a diverse multinational cohort. We included urban, we included rural, we included low-income countries, we included middle-income countries, we included high-income countries, we We included people of all socioeconomic strata. We included all racial groups. So we had Indians, we had Chinese, we had black, we had white, we had Arabs. We had every race represented, African tribes, everyone represented across the board, the whole world. We are able to see the effect. So what more? I mean, you can't do better than that. What more can you do? No, you can't go to the moon and no study there. No, the moon will it work in the moon? You cannot say the whole India, whole world only you can study. We have done it. We already done it in 21 countries, and we are still expanding. We are adding more countries. Now, what are the side effects of milk? All this is great. Is there any side effects? There are side effects, of course. There are people who are lactose intolerant. For example, if you have, it should be lactose, not lactic. So lactose intolerant. So lactose intolerance is quite common. In fact, there are many people who get stomach upsets, and if they drink it, it can be from birth, it can be acquired also. Maybe 40 years, 50 years, suddenly you start getting, you're not able to digest the milk. Something goes wrong in your digestive system. So the moment you drink, you get diarrhea, bloating, this, that. Well, you will have to drink alternate forms of milk, because lactose intolerance is common. It's about 30-40% of people seem to have it. So if you have it and you diagnose it, often getting bloating, this, that, then you should go easy on the milk, or you try. They may not have it with dairy. For example, yogurt, they may not have it at all. But with milk, it is quite common. Allergies and eczema, especially in children, you may get little pimples and eczema and so on. Acne in teenagers. If consumed in excess, this comes from Walt Willett's group in Harvard, where they have shown if you drink too much of milk, more than 3 glasses of milk every day, if you drink, there is a slight increase in prostate cancer. This has been shown. Why they develop prostate cancer, we don't know. But there is a thing. So don't drink too much of milk, because it is from an animal source, and there could be, proteins which are different from human, and therefore a limited amount is probably good for you. And surprisingly, the very thing which is supposed to protect you from fractures and osteoporosis, you drink too much of it, it seems to increase bone fractures. Now, this has also been shown. So if you overdo your milk, you may get bone fractures and so on. So a glass of milk is what is recommended, not more than that. Finally, conclusion, I come to the end of my talk. So the conclusions are, from my own studies, that higher total dairy consumption was associated with a lower prevalence of diabetes and metabolic syndrome, lower incidence, prevalence is cross-sectional, incidence is new onset, longitudinal, lower incidence of diabetes, hypertension, and metabolic syndrome, lower risk of mortality and cardiovascular disease, particularly stroke, but also heart attacks, and even non-CVD deaths. It means deaths from any causes. That means other causes of cancer, it must be protected. If it is protecting you from all-cause mortality and from non-CVD deaths, many of those deaths will be due to other diseases like cancers and so on. So therefore, in general, probably it's protecting you from certain cancers as well. And therefore, my take-home message, which is my last slide, is that consumption of dairy should be encouraged, especially in low and middle-income countries with poor diet quality and poor protein intake. There's no getting away from the fact that milk is a very good source of protein and therefore should be taken, and that is a very good source of calcium. Many of our women don't have enough calcium, and men, and therefore you should take, and we should promote dairy in a big way. And this is not because I'm asked by you. I didn't make up all this research after you asked me to give the talk. I had the data with me. And therefore, as an independent scientist, I believe that dairy is good for you. And I do not subscribe to the view that cutting off yogurt and milk from your diet will protect against diabetes. I simply don't buy into that. And I believe that to make your diet more balanced, in fact, you should take yogurt every day and a glass of milk every day. That's my conclusion. So I'm going to stop here. And if there are any questions, I'll be happy to.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohan.
It
is most outstanding eye-opener, and probably all the dairymen of India will be very, very happy today, because it has come from the practitioner's mouth. And we'll take a few questions, but we are really very happy. And a few questions which are probably within from our group. I will request Dr. Kaushik to ask the question directly because he wrote in the chat box.
Yeah, Dr. Mohan, it was very interesting and very informative. My question is related to ghee. So do you have some study where ghee has been used as a protective against the diabetes and CVD?
As I said, in our study, both butter and ghee, of course, is only consumed in South Asia. So we cannot get that. And a pure study will get diluted when you do that. So we could not use that. Butter itself, the actual consumption of the butter as such, people taking butter is not high enough. In many parts of the world, they don't even take. And the perception of the public is that ghee is bad, butter is bad. So many people don't really take butter at all. So we were not powered enough to do that. Maybe as the pure progresses and we have more countries and more people, we may be able to look at butter and ghee separately. But we must remember that butter is saturated fat, because after all, from the milk, you're removing the fat and then you're taking it as concentrated fat, and that fat is definitely saturated fat. And saturated fat, we know, does increase the cholesterol level and the LDL cholesterol level. So I would not be surprised that if you took lots of butter and so on, it will increase your LDL cholesterol levels. We don't have enough evidence to say that just because of that, you will die. In fact, Masjid Dengan's another paper, which became very famous, was before this dairy one came the previous year, as also part of that in the Lancet, where she looked at carbohydrate separately and fat separately. Which is worse? You know, carbohydrate worse and fat worse? What we concluded there was carbohydrate is actually worse, just like my rice hypothesis. So carbohydrate increase your triglyceride, decrease your HDL, so it's actually worse. The fat, you must remember that there are also good fats. There are monounsaturated fat, there's polyunsaturated fat, which is actually good. Omega-3 fatty acid, that's also good. So which contains in fish and so on. So there are a lot of good fats also. So the evidence against fat is not that strong. But having said that, I wouldn't, you know, pitch for taking ghee and butter and so on. But if you ask me, if you take a little ghee every day, you know, a spoon of desi ghee, if you take every day, I don't think you'll, at that quantity, I don't think when you're taking all healthy food, you're taking fruits, you're taking vegetables, just because you took a spoon of ghee, you're not going to die. In fact, I take it. So if you think that it's really going to, be good for your taste and things like that, I don't think in those small quantities it really does any harm. But I must say that we don't have much studies on ghee as such. The problem is when in fact, doing dietary studies is very difficult, because when you don't eat, you know, you don't drink milk alone, you don't drink this alone. So even doing these studies, many will criticize us, saying that they have done all this on dairy, but people eat all other things. But you know what we have done? We have captured each item in the food frequency separately. And we have done correction for all of that. Statistically, we have corrected for this, corrected for that, corrected for this, corrected for that. Everything is, that's why there are no Lancet and New England Journal will not publish just like that. They take through so many reviews, so many things, so many questions will be asked before they publish this thing. But I think ghee, in limited quantities, if you like it, you take it, but it is saturated fat. You must know that. And we don't have enough data on that.
Very small question. It's very clear that they have the protective effect. Do we expect that they also have the therapeutic effect as well, the dairy products or milk-based products? Like some person has developed diabetes. Can you prescribe to go on dairy foods?
I think if, as a general plan, we are suggesting, along with, because you saw in that protective thing that we saw, fruits and vegetables also came out, vegetables particularly came out protective. So suppose you're recommending a healthy diet to somebody, leave alone diabetes and protection from good health, immunity. Let's say in the context of COVID, you're talking about building up immunity. I would definitely say fruits and vegetables will come right on top, and dairy and yogurt particularly will come right on top. It will come. So if you take a glass of milk for the calcium, yogurt with your meal for the probiotic part, improves your gut microbiota, and then the fruits and vegetables from the antioxidant part, and then maybe a little seeds or things also added on for the, you know, phytonutrient part, which you can put in your milk and take. In fact, that's what I do. I have a glass of milk in which I put chia seeds and pumpkin seeds. They have very, very strong antioxidant effect. And so in my glass of milk, in my bowl of milk I have every morning, that's my breakfast, in fact. That and some fruit is my breakfast. And so in that I put the seeds as well. in it. So I think that that makes it very, very healthy. So I would say yes, because especially in children, or suppose they drink a glass of milk, they'll eat less of the dosa or rice or whatever. They'll automatically, their appetite will go down and they will cut down on some of the other carbs. So naturally protein is going up and carbs will cut down. So I would say yes, as a protective diet, as a healthy diet, we're planning, we're coming out with India's health, diet card kind of a thing. In that, definitely we will include both milk as well as yogurt. We may not include ghee in that, but we will say, take healthy fats, we'll say. For example, monounsaturated fat in some form, if you can, for there you'll get groundnut oil, mustard oil, gingerly oil. These are the mufa oils. So among the oils, we'll put that on top and bring ghee around a little lower down.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Dr. Mohan. Our Western Chairman, Sri Arun Patil, would like to have some comments. And
sure. Yes, Dr.
Dr. Mohan, thank you very much. It's a beautiful presentation. Best on the facts, best on the scientific data. My only observation is that as a dairy man, we are now being facing a lot of problems, especially from the vegetarian and vegan and all those lobbies. So we have to have a very efficient and wide-reaching mechanism of spreading this goodness of the milk and milk products. So my simple question was that, what best efforts you people are doing? And we will like to join hands with you, because basically it is our mandate to protect the interests of the milk producers of this country, which are 95% landless laborers, small landholders, or marginal farmers.
Yeah.
So that is one very important thing.
One of the reasons why I immediately accepted when Dr. Prajapati asked me was because I am in line with what you are saying, not to protect the farmers and not to protect that. That's not my immediate interest, although if it helps the farmers, because then they'll say there are also people producing tobacco. You're going to, tobacco lobby will say, so many million people, you're going to, their jobs will go. What are you going to do? Why are you talking against tobacco and all that? Tobacco lobby will do the exact opposite. I cannot even have a meeting in a hotel which is run by a thing. I say, I'm only going to the hotel, No, but that is, your tobacco lobby. So these are very sensitive, issues. But for me, I just keep the science aside. And I say, I'm a scientist. I'm not bothered about the farmers and think that is not my job. That's for the government to do and somebody else to do. And incidentally, if it helps them to for their thing, so be it. But taking the science apart, I thought, that with so much about vegan, everywhere we go, because I'm a vegetarian, I used to be a non-vegetarian, but I gave up. And now the only non-vegetarian I take is egg white, because I believe that some more protein. As a vegetarian, I didn't want to lose out on my protein. And therefore, I take egg white along with my milk, a glass of milk, little fruit, and my egg white. That's my morning breakfast. It gives me a lot of protein and very sight with the seeds which I put inside. And so I don't even feel hungry at lunch. So much protein is there in that way. So I believe that this should be propagated. So one of the ways would be that, of course, in talks like this, but I'm talking to the converted now, I'm preaching to the converted. All of you know that, and I'm preaching to the converted now. So if there are other forums where, to the public, of course, there'll be a lot of opposition. People will immediately come. Vegan group will say, this is all funded by something, and a dairy probably funded him to talk. And whenever I say anything, there'll be some opposition. Or even if I say, something good, even for that also, there'll be opposition. Today in social media, there are mad fellows who just want to create problem all the time. Whatever you do, you can be the biggest saint. Even to them, they will go and say. So let's not worry about them. If we believe about the science, then wherever there are other forums, I'll be happy to join you and present the science as I did today, And suppose you're making recommendations and things like that, include all our papers. Suppose you're producing a white paper. Put all these papers inside. They're all published in the best journals. Lancet. How can anybody go against a Lancet or BMJ and, all these British Journal of Nutrition and American Journal of Nutrition? And you cannot go against the best journals in the world, PLOS One and all. So you use all that. Then when articles are being written on something, we can join you. If there is something in social media where you promote these, you take these papers and you promote it and let that come. I can make short videos, for example. You might have seen my YouTube videos. They're all on things like this, 3-minute, 4-minute videos. And I think I have spoken about milk and all in my next year. I've produced 81 videos. And those videos, three of them have crossed 1 million views. And I think 12 or 13 have crossed 1 lakh views, and many have crossed many thousand views. So they have become very popular. I have now 41,000 subscribers on YouTube. I have 1,32,000 followers on YouTube, on Facebook. So like this, on each of them, I have and I joined social media 1 year ago, on January 20th, 2020. Until then, I didn't know what is Facebook, what is Twitter, what is YouTube. I didn't have a single video. I didn't have time. Somehow this COVID helped me sitting at home. So I said, let me get into it. And so that's how I got it. So that's a very powerful media. But you can expect backlash. Immediately, there'll be people, because they've got a lot of vested interest. You know, a lot of industries who are promoting other things, saying vegan, this, that, their keto diet. If you talk about keto diet, what is the most unbalanced diet? Zero carbohydrate. I'm saying carbohydrate is bad. Too much of carbohydrate. That doesn't mean zero. No, you cannot bring it down to zero and eat 80% fat. That's what the keto fellows are saying. The moment I say keto diet is not good, it'll increase your cholesterol, increase your thing, they'll all come down on me and say, oh, you are biased, you are this, you are that. So that we can expect it. But then truth is always truth, and therefore we have to continue to promote it, you know. And so from that kind of a thing, how you find out how best this can be promoted, how best, in a, which forums we can participate, I'll be more than happy to do that.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much for your...
Thank you, Doctor.
Sir, we have with us Professor A.K. Srivastava.
Oh, yes, joined us. Okay.
He could not join earlier because of some busy meeting.
Yeah.
So, Srivastava, sir, we want to see you and have a few words from you. Aap thoda video on kijiye or mic. Srivastava, sir.
So meanwhile, there are a couple of questions here I can ask. I think Dr. Irja is asking, will a glass of milk and a bowl of curd have the same benefit? I would expect that because even the earlier studies that I showed, two or three of them showed the benefit of yogurt, but not that much. But they didn't say the others were bad, but the benefit they showed was more in yogurt. So I think the fermentation part and the gut microbiota part of it, I think, adds one more value other than the milk. And I don't think they're competitive to each other. I think they both should be taken. Take a glass of milk and then take yogurt with, say, two major meals if you take yogurt. Then you get your dairy also, enough dairy you get. And at the same time, I think you get, and of course, you should not have sweetened yogurt. If you go and put sugar in it, then you're going to, or put too much salt in it, then you're going to kill it. But otherwise, I think yogurt itself is very good. And if some of them have, you know, other probiotics added to them, even better. So we can do that. So that's one. The other thing from Dr. Sunita Grover is any other non-bovine milk, camel milk. So this camel milk theory actually came up from Rajasthan, from Bikaner, where Dr. Agarwal actually first reported saying that in a particular in the Raika community, in Bikaner, there is no diabetes at all. And so his hypothesis was that it's due to the camel milk. Now, again, it was circumstantial evidence. There was no actual evidence for that. And then as a contra to that was that the highest evidence of diabetes and obesity was in Middle East, where they drink a lot of camel milk. So what happened to the camel milk there? Then you must say Indian camel milk is different from that. The A1A2 will bring in all the other theories. Both NIN as well as ICMR took this up, and a lot of studies were done on camel milk. They said it has insulin in camel milk. If you have insulin in camel milk, you'll get hypoglycemia if you drink it. You know, if you have inside the milk, you put insulin, what will happen to you if you drink? You'll get hypoglycemia. So there was no insulin-like products, nothing was there. Mechanistic studies were totally a thing. Then we went deeper into the Raika milk, Raika thing, and we found they were extremely thin. They are walking in the desert and they're walking, you know, miles and miles and miles. They're walking, they're thick, thin. So they don't have obesity. That is why they don't have. In many parts of Jharkhand, when they were so poor, they didn't have diabetes as well, not because of camel milk. So I think it relates more to obesity and so on. And the camel milk theory is really not been proven. Although I was surprised that Amul was, when it was advertising, they were actually saying that, it contains protective anti-diabetic thing and all. I think that's taking it a bit far. it has not been, I think the government should not do that without, or a cooperative should not do that without real proof. We can say it's good, milk is good, but we cannot claim things which are not there, not scientifically proven. What about soy milk for lactose? Yes, you can. So that is what, that is the alternative forms of milk, but it really won't come under milk, you know. Soy milk and almond milk is not really milk. So it is only a substitute.
We don't call it a milk, or rather we don't
call it a milk. Really not a milk. So soy is good. Yeah. But then soy also is supposed to contain some estrogens and so on. So you have to be a little careful about soy as well, promoting it. I think data on gut micro needs to be generated in consumption of milk and dairy products. I think we should. And I'll be very happy to work with in y'all in creating such data. Maybe in those who drink milk, don't drink milk, we can look at. Incidentally, I want to give you the good news. I told you the other day that two of our gut microbiota papers are just been accepted in genome medicine. The work with Professor Balkrishna Nair and Sharmila Mande and the Danish group. It's an Indo-Danish study looking at gut microbiota. Both those papers have been now accepted in genome medicine. One on the link of the diabetes with gut microbiota and pre-diabetes with gut microbiota. Back to back, they'll come in the same journal. So that's the only study I have done on gut microbiota, but we need to do more. And we are doing some other studies now. For example, we're looking at sweeteners, because they say that if you take artificial sweeteners, the gut microbiota gets altered. I'm not sure about that. So I'm doing a study to really look. I don't think in the small quantities they will, but I'm going to look at that because there's some data on that. So we need to look at such things, and it'll be very nice to see actually two trials before milk and then after milk and after yogurt to see whether the gut microbiota is changed. That'd be a beautiful study to do.
Yes. Sir, thank you very much. We have a veteran professor, Shailendra.
Yes.
He is probably one senior most dairy man here. He has worked with Dr. Welcome to the session, and we'll be very pleased to have a question from you or comment.
Thanks, Dr. Prajapati. Dr. Mohan, I congratulate you. It was a very nice talk and quite informative for people like us. Of course, I am not in this domain. I'm a lay person. I'm more of a social scientist. But it was quite interesting and also highly informative for us. Right. Of course, my question, out of curiosity, maybe I don't know, out of, again, as a lay person, you were very convincingly explaining. Yeah, one, of course, is first question is rather a clarification. So did you find any difference in terms of rural-urban pattern, anything of that nature? First question, of course, because we come from rural management institution and our dairies, cooperative dairies, focus a lot on rural segment. So I was just curious to know whether there is any kind of, you know, insights. That is one aspect. Second, of course, again, a more lay person's kind of argument. Fine, you said that dairy and dairy products are protective against many of these ailments, right? Okay, but in general, our understanding is that, again, of course, I'm a lay person. In general, all these, you know, heart diseases and many such diseases are increasing, right? So maybe consumption of milk and milk products are also increasing, right? Maybe if you see the total food proportions, maybe they are also increasing, right? And if one were to do a study, let us say isolated study, and take meat and come up with the same kind of finding, possible, right? If one, I take just meat and say, and conduct similar studies longitudinal, and it might tell that meat is protective. Meat is protective. So now, just as your study is saying, milk is protective. But there could be possibly total effect of this food combination, and that could be the possible reason as to why there is an increase in the heart diseases or diabetes and such things. So how do we take that total effect? Of course, ordinarily, everyone says that moderation is always good. That has been our, you know, advice from our parents, or, you know, traditionally. Moderation is always good. In some sense, your arguments also telling everything in moderation is good. But now, how do you explain this contradiction that though milk consumption is going up, Your study is telling it it's protective, right? So is there any impact of other food items and how do we isolate?
So there are about three or four questions in this. I'll split them off and then join. The first is, are there urban and rural differences? Yeah. Now, urban and rural differences are huge in some countries and in some states. For example, if you take Jharkhand, and I mentioned Jharkhand because it was the first state we did in our INDIAB study. In Jharkhand, we found the poor people were extremely poor, whereas the rich, and to some extent Bihar and UP also, same thing came. Very, very poor in the poor people. When you go to a town in Jharkhand, that is mostly Tata Steel and Jamshedpur, and so those places, they are fairly well off because they're all paid white collar jobs people and so on. Huge differences in diabetes. Now, it's the same Jharkhand people. Okay. Now, this is not due to milk or not due to anything else. It's not due to one single item. It's because of prosperity. Now, because of prosperity, what happened? A lot of things happen. Number one is they will start going by car or scooter or something instead of walking. Number two, they'll have more food. In the rural area, they'll be hardly eating twice a day. Here, they're eating three times a day and so on. Junk foods come in. So that's one of the main reasons why diabetes is increasing, heart disease is increasing. 30 years ago, even if you take a thing like rice, the rice mills there in 1970s, there were 29 rice mills in India. Today, there are 1.5 lakh rice mills in India. Okay. That means rice is getting polished more and more, becomes, you know, white and it becomes high glycemic index. Both are rice, but that is a, you know, nice brown rice with a lot of husk and a lot of B complex, a lot of protein, a lot of fiber, a lot of phytonutrients, everything, all gone. Now we've got only the carbohydrate. So rice and rice, you cannot compare because that is a different rice with a different rice. So that is one thing which changes. Second is actual amounts that you eat. Because you become richer now, you can eat a lot of fat, a lot of sugar, a lot of junk food. You're eating, I told you, I didn't even know what pizza was in 1979. Now who doesn't know pizza? Everybody's eating pizza and burgers and everything they're eating. So that's the second thing. Then obesity rate. Obesity rates have gone up like this. When I was in school, in my whole school, there was one obese child, one fellow. And they used to call him fatty, fatty, fatty. Every time he's a little fatty fellow. Today, one third of the class is fat. You know, everybody is fat. So a thin fellow, they'll say, ah, thin fellow, thin fellow, thin fellow. So how much it has changed? Now, that is what is causing heart disease and so on. Not because milk was taken or milk was not taken. That is not the reason. It is because the whole society has changed. Obesity has increased, stress factors have increased, children are not playing in the field anymore because it's not safe to play. When I finish school, 2 hours I'll play, then only I'll come to study. Now they'll come straight either tuition or they'll be watching computer game or they'll be sitting in front of the TV or they'll be watching something. The whole lifestyle has changed. That is what has produced more diabetes, heart disease and thing. Not any particular thing you ate or any particular thing. So that is a completely different thing. Same thing for urban and rural. But if you take a state like Kerala, okay, urban-rural differences are gone in Kerala. There's no urban, no rural. In fact, rural Kerala, if you define, is having more diabetes, more obesity than urban. It is in urban, there are a little more. They'll go to gym and they'll... rural people don't even do that. So those differences, as the state, kind of matures and comes up, those urban-rural differences will go away. And in a rich state, you'll find the urban-rural differences going away. In a poor state, you'll find these big differences. Now, coming to meat and so on. Yes, it depends on how the study is done. And if the study is done, you may get one study isolated. For example, in Pure, there was one group which is working on it, actually saying that meat was was actually protective. And all. I got out of that study. I said, look, I don't believe this. Some artifact is coming and I don't want to be part of this particular paper. I excused myself and I got out of it, you know. And because 99% of studies are saying it's bad. So one study comes like that, it'll be an outlier. When you put a meta-analysis, one study will be sticking out there. That is why you need a meta-analysis. It can't be that 10 studies are wrong. No? 10 studies, 20 studies, how can they be wrong? When they're done in different countries, different method, different sample, different urban, rural, different. So the method will come out. What I'm showing you is, they're all meta-analysis showing the same protective effect. It cannot be all the 15 studies are wrong for dairy. Still dairy is bad. All the 15 are bad. Then why do the science? Then do any study. Don't do any study then. No? Then brand it as bad and then start to beginning itself. So that is where science has to be balanced. Is the study good? What is the sample size? And you're talking about 150,000 people who have been followed for 15 years in 21 countries who didn't have a disease, who later developed it. How much better than that can it get? There's no study in humanity, in humankind, which has produced data like that. You know, nobody can argue. Even your worst critics cannot argue when this data is so powerful. Nobody can argue against that. So I think, yes, if you find something in isolation, maybe there's bias there. Maybe somebody has funded that study to do it like that. Maybe it is wrong sampling. Something like that can go wrong. But that will be very easily found out. They'll tear it apart. You know, somebody else from another nutrition group will tear it apart. And the study will be so badly criticized, they'll have to withdraw the study. Okay. So, yes, as regarding meat itself, I think red meat is still not good. It, apart from producing diabetes and heart disease, not produce cancers. Some of these red meat things are not at all good. But you can't say the same thing about poultry or about fish. You know, so fish and, again, fish has to be pure fish. Today, it is all contaminated with mercury and, you know, all kinds of things. The fish that you get there is completely contaminated. How can you say the fish is safe to eat? Similarly, if you go and inject your chicken with all kinds of hormones, you inject it inside. How can you say it's good? So everything has to be prepared in a proper way, in an organic way, without any adulteration, without anything. Then you'll have to study and see how it is. Any hypothesis you can start with. You can start by saying fish is bad, you know, and then see whether what the data shows. I think ultimately when you have proper studies done in the proper way with proper sample size, proper statistical analysis, the truth will ultimately come out. But some things it is difficult. One study will say coffee is bad. One study will say coffee is good. Next, you just study 3 months thing, you'll find coffee coming three times saying three different things. Very difficult because one cup of coffee you drink among so many things you do in life, how can you collect it that one cup of coffee is the one which produces everything? You know, it's very difficult to get such things done. But to answer your question, same question here, in the food frequency analysis, we take rice separately, oil separately, this separately, that separately. Because we have all that in such large numbers, we can adjust. We'll say, what if you took the oil out? What if you took the, you know, non-veg out? Is it there in vegetarians? Is it there in things? When you same, see, that's why I showed you, in the low dairy countries also, I'm seeing the same effect. In the high dairy things also, I'm seeing the same effect. In males also, I'm seeing the same thing. In females also, I'm seeing the same thing. In different age groups also, I'm seeing the same thing. When the data is so consistent, it has to be true.
Yes.
Thanks.
Very good, Dr. Mohan. We are very happy that you clearly mentioned and also clarified our doubts. Actually, I had a call from Dr. Srivastava. Even though it's shown on the screen, he has gone again back to the meeting.
No, I understand.
He was only for 2 minutes in between. So he told that you can conclude without me, and I will talk with Dr. Mohan later on.
Please so, thank him for the slides. He sent me slides and I used them. So
I wrote to him also yesterday. So with this, I am on behalf of IRMA, the Varghese Kurian Center of Excellence, the Indian Dairy Association Gujarat State Chapter, and all of our colleagues here at IRMA. I thank profusely Dr. Mohan for his very enlightening lecture. And we are all very happy that we learned a lot. Probably every dairyman who is watching this thing and who will be watching this video, because this link will be shared with many people. Once it goes to our cooperatives, groups are known, it will go to at least 1 million people. And then it will be a good strength for us that we could know the results from our mouth from this study, pure study. And we were not knowing before that such a big study has been conducted on 150,000 patients and so also. So it is very good support for us. And as you agreed on our Patil sir's question, that we'll be helping further also in promoting the science of...
If I can just interrupt, sir, suddenly just something struck me. Yes. You were asking how to make this go to a wider, apart from the 1 million people of your own fraternity who will be watching it. Probably a press release or something like that about the talk and the main factors. If you send it, that will go wide in the media. And then the media will pick it up. And then people say, oh, milk is not so bad. Actually, milk is good. We need that to come, you know. And for that tipping point to come, not once, but repeatedly, we'll have to do it so that all the negative things go away. It just struck me when you're talking.
Sure, sir. That I only thought, because this will be the best content with us to share with the media. And probably I'll be taking help of our Amul group also.
Yeah.
and NDDB, National Dairy Development Board, and our IDA. We are all together to promote the science of milk. So once again, I thank you very much. And also I'm thankful to our colleagues who have joined this meeting in Zoom as well as on YouTube, especially Sri Arun Patilji and Dr. Kaushik, Dr. Nirja, Dr. Sunita Grover, and all professors from IRMA, and the other people, faculty sitting on the YouTube. And so actually I restricted Zoom sharing, and that is why we, just to avoid the disturbances of other things and so. But we will be definitely sharing your live recording to all the stakeholders. And it is our pleasure, and we are very highly thankful to you, sir, for giving an excellent eye-opening lecture to all of you. So with this, I also thank my director, Professor Srivastava from IRMA, and also my mentors from the dairy fraternity. Some of the important persons were traveling now, and that is why he told that please share us. And those people who are in USA, another thing, they are at midnight. So that was it will be our pleasure to watch it when we wake up. So definitely we'll be sharing this video very quickly. And then all of you, once again, thank for being present with us. And this is a wonderful 1.5 hour with you, sir. So with this, I once again thank you very much.
Thank you.